So here I have a machine that is running CrowdSec, Nginx, and the Nginx remediation component. And here I have the machine that I will use to perform some attacks. So to install or to enable CrowdSec on our setup, we simply go to the quick start of the application security component, and we're installing two collections. And I'm going to explain as we go on what we are doing. So we install the AppSec virtual patching and the AppSec generic rules collection. What it does somehow is that the AppSec virtual patching is a base collection that will recommend to most people. And as you can see, it will contain various scenarios to either virtual patch. So sorry, I use the term virtual patch without explaining it. Virtual patch is when we write a rule that is here to prevent the specific exploitation of one very well-known vulnerability. It's not something that is very generic. It's something that targets, for example, this CV from 2017 that is focused on PHP unit that for some reason is still popular nowadays, which is a remote code execution. So this is a virtual patching rule. So either some rules that are targeting some very well-known vulnerabilities or some rules that are a bit more generic and that are here to prevent some well-known, you know, bad behavior, such as people that are scanning your website for .env files that very often contain credentials. So this has been installed on CrowdSec. And now as well, what we're going to do is that we're going to add what we call acquisition. So AppSec.yaml. I'm going to explain as we do what we're doing. So here what we're doing is that we're taking CrowdSec. Okay, we're going to start a new service that is going to run on the loopback on the port 7422. And we're going to load the AppSec config AppSec default, which is the one that we installed just before and we showcased. So this is enough from CrowdSec point of view, at least, to run the AppSec component. So now I'm going to restart CrowdSec. If we look at the logs of CrowdSec, we can now see that CrowdSec, when starting, tells, OK, I'm creating a TCP server on the loopback for 7422, and AppSec runner is ready to process it. So CrowdSec is now ready to process some HP requests from the remediation component. So now we are going to go over to the remediation component. Here we are using Nginx with its associative remediation component. We are going to go into the configuration of our Nginx remediation component. And we are going to add the AppSec URL. So here what we are doing is simply that we are telling Nginx, or to the remediation component of Nginx, hey buddy, look, there is now an AppSec engine that is available for you. Please forward your request to this URI, and your request will be able to be analyzed and protected. Okay, and so we do this as well. So now we can restart Nginx. Okay, so once we restart Nginx, we are going to keep an eye on the CrowdSec logs. Somehow we have our setup done and running. So here I have my machine that we use for the demo purpose of the attack. What I'm going to do is that we're going to verify that things are running correctly. Okay, I have here, I'm accessing my website, everything is fine. However, if now I do, for example, try to access a .env file on my website, I get a 403 forbidden. Why? Because as we saw just before in the AppSec virtual patching, we have a rule that is here to prevent people trying to access URIs that once lowercase are ending with .env. And so if we look back at our CrowdSec, and if we are looking back at CrowdSec, we get here the rules that was triggered via patch and access. We can maybe inspect a bit the alert. And what we're going to see is that, OK, this IP triggered this rule, the rules that we just showed before, and that the zone was matched in the file name, the method, it was a head request because we use curl -e, and the target URI was .env. Okay, cool. So this is like the basic behavior of this. However, now if we go back to this, and instead of accessing one single performing one single bad request, we are going to try to do a few ones. We are going to try to access a .env file. We are then going to try to exploit the, like pretend to exploit at least the PHP unit vulnerability that we spoke about before. And we are going as well to pretend that we are here to try to exploit or scanning the website for Laravel in debug mode. So if we are doing this, we see that each of our requests gets individually blocked as expected. So here we get the info. However, and more interestingly, we can see that our IP triggered the CrowdSec AppSec VPatch scenario and is now banned for 4 hours. So what it means that if we look back at our alert list, we have the rules that we try to exploit, and we have as well a scenario that this time led to a decision against our IP. And so it means that if now we look, for example, at the decision list, my IP is now banned for 4 hours. And if we try to understand a bit why, and we go into the scenario AppSec VPatch, it's because we have as well in the collection a CrowdSec scenario that says, if we see the same IP getting blocked more than twice by two different rules of the WAF, we are going to ban it for 4 hours. And so this is typically the kind of things where combining CrowdSec with the WAF is very interesting, because not only we're able to virtual patch individual stuff, and you will always be missing some virtual patching rules. However, with enough rules that are going to detect, you know, known malevolent behavior, we'll be able to ban the attacker for a long time, and then we're going to significantly increase his difficulty. As a former, let's say, person from the offensive security side, bypassing WAF is a hobby for a lot of people. And here what we are trying to do is that we do not leave room to the guy to try to bypass virtual patching rules, etc., by making his life harder, banning him for a longer time, so he needs to rotate IP and so on, and we make his life in general a lot more difficult. Plus, if we're in the console, now I go to the console. My machine is, of course, enrolled in the console, as you should. And here, what we are going to see is that we can see information about what we are doing just before. So I can see, for example, this was me trying to access the .env file. We can get the information here. This was me trying to access the VPatch Laravel debug mode, where we can get some very detailed information about what it is associated to. And finally, we can find the scenario that was triggered because that means that this IP tried to exploit at least those two vulnerabilities, so VPatch CV 2017, the PHP unit one, and the Laravel debug mode, and we get the URIs that were targeted. So just by, let's say, literally adding a few lines of configuration to our existing setup, we gained WAF capabilities. And as stated before, we are here on something that is really focused toward virtual patching and so on, so would be or is very low risk.